get started here. I'm covering lots of material today. We're going to finish up the last few problems from section 4.5. And 4.6 is actually an extension of 4.5, more on curve sketching, except we're going to be doing rational functions and stuff. So, and then we're getting into, my goal is to get into chapter 4.7 today, which is optimization, more word problems. And these are huge and very important word problems that I guarantee you you're going to be hit hard on in terms of the final exam and stuff. So this is, again, last couple of questions from section 4.5. So here's your first one here. A cubic function f of x equals ax cubed plus cx squared plus d has a local minimum value of 8 when x equals negative 2 and a local maximum value of 8 when x equals negative 2 and a local minimum value of 6 at x equals 0. Your mission on this problem, this is right off of web work, by the way. You're supposed to tell me what A is, what C is, and what D is. This is what web work wants you to do. But you've got to use detective work to be able to figure this thing out. So let's write down the information and talk about what this information means. A cubic function, so here's my model here. I have f of x is equal to ax cubed plus cx squared plus d. Has a local maximum value of 8 at x equals negative 2. Listen, look at this problem. Has a local maximum value of 8 at x equals negative 2. That tells me two things right there. The first thing it tells me is I have an ordered pair. The point is negative 2, 8. But it also telling me it's a maximum. Maximums or minimums, I know something about maxes and mins. What do we know? The derivative is equal to, did you learn anything in this class? Come on, start. The derivative at max and min points are equal to what? Zero. All right, 0. So that also tells me f prime of negative 2 is equal to 0. That's a lot of information from that one little sentence there. Again, we're playing detective work on trying to figure out what A, C, and D are. And a local minimum value of 6 at x equals 0. That also tells me two pieces of the puzzle. It tells me I have the point 0, 6. When x equals 0, the y-coordinate is 6. And it also tells me my derivative at 0 is also equal to 0. Does that make sense? All right, but I'm going to use this information to figure out what A, C, and D are. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to use the two points. The first point is f of negative 2. That tells me A times negative 2 cubed plus C times negative 2 squared plus D is equal to the y-coordinate 8. I plugged in negative 2 for all the x-coordinates. Let's clean this thing up. Negative 2 cubed is negative 8a. Plus negative 2 squared is 4. 4c plus d equals 8. Let's just hold that in reserve for a second. But that gives me an equation that has my letters of interest, A, C, and D in it. Okay? The other point is f of 0 is equal to 6. But f of 0 is a times 0 cubed plus c times 0 squared plus d equals 6. That's also going to tell me some information. And that actually tells me something rather interesting. What is that? Well, 0 cubed is 0 times a is 0, so that goes away. 0 squared is 0 times c is 0, so that goes away. That tells me pretty much d equals what?
6.
And I've got one of my answers already done. It's a detective game. So you're analyzing the information, what it means to be a point, and what it means to be a maximum or minimum. The derivative is equal to 0. So now I've used this as my two points information here. Okay? And now I'm going to use the derivative information. So let's talk about the derivative. Remember, A, C, and D are constants. They're constants. So leave them alone. What is the derivative of ax cubed plus cx squared plus d? Constants hold over. What's the derivative of x cubed? So that'll be 3ax squared, because constants hold over, plus, what's the root of cx squared?
2cx.
2cx, and what is the root of d? Zero, because d is a constant. Does that make sense? All right, so there's my derivative. Now I'm going to plug in these two pieces of the puzzle here. F prime of 2 equals 0. So f prime of negative 2, f prime of negative 2 would be 3a times negative 2 squared plus 2c times negative 2. And that officially, because it's a max min point, has to be equal to 0. Let's clean it up. Negative 2 quantity squared. Negative 2 times negative 2 is 4. Times 3 is 12. So this gives me 12a. 2 times c times negative 2. 2 times negative 2 is a minus 4c equals 0. There's more information. Does that make sense? Well, that also tells me this. I'm going to put the c on the other side. So I'm going to add 4c to both sides. This cancels. That gives me 12a is equal to 4c. And just to make it easy, I'm going to solve for c. What's c equal to if I divide both sides by 4? 3a equals c. So there is another piece of the puzzle. The relationship between a and c, 3 times a is equal to c. The other piece of the puzzle is this one. F prime of 0 equals 0. But f prime, there's f prime right here. When I plug in 0, I get 3 times a times 0 squared plus 2 times c times 0 equals 0. But 0 squared is 0, times a 3a is still 0. 2c times 0 is 0. This is telling me that 0 equals 0. As factual as that is, that's not giving me any information about the problem. Does that make sense? The derivative, plugging 0 into the derivative didn't tell me anything. But the other ones did, and I think I got enough information to solve for the rest of them. So I'm going to pull it over here. I've got negative 8a plus 4c plus d equals 8. I got d equals 6, and I got 3a equals c. These are the three pieces of the puzzle that I have here. Can you, from this information, solve for a, c, and d? Well, we got d, and what I'm going to do here is now do substitution. I'm going to plug in d, I'm going to plug in 6 for d, and I'm going to replace c with 3a, and I'm going to basically, by substitution, come up with this. This implies that negative 8a plus 4 times c, but c is 3a, plus d, but d equals 6, is equal to 8. I substituted. Does that make sense? So c got replaced with 3a, d got replaced with 6, and it gives me an equation with how many letters in it that I have to solve for? Just one. You can solve for a. Well, let's clean this up. Negative 8a plus 12a plus 6 equals 8. What's negative 8a plus 12a?
4a.
4a plus 6 equals 8. Subtract 6 from both sides. I get 4a equals 2. That implies when I divide by 4 on both sides, a equals 1 half. And I got that guy up here, a is 1 half. Again, it's a detective game, but it's reinforcing your understanding about ordered pairs and max, mins, and the derivatives being 0. And once you got a, c is real easy because look at your relationship. C is equal to 3a. So I back substitute in here, and that's going to give me c equals 3 times a, which is a half, which makes it 3 halves. Now, of course, on your problems, they'll change. On web work, they'll change the numbers, but the idea is going to be the same. Does that make sense? Did I lose you guys anywhere? And again, this is a system of equation thing.
I lost me to c, I'm sorry.
Well, remember, 3a was equal to c, right? And once you had a, you told me a was a half. I can plug in, substitute, back substitute in for a. So c equals 3 times a. 3 times a half is 3 halves, and that's all I got, c, and I win the game. Does that make sense? And again, the way to treat this stuff, honestly, it really is. It's a game. Okay? Let's take a look at this one right here. This kind of leads us into section 4.6, but it actually is with your 4.5 notes. Basically, we're going to be doing curb sketching, graphing the function they give us through looking at the derivatives and the other things that you guys learned in, I don't know, high school algebra 1, algebra 2, pre-calculus, college algebra stuff here. We're going to be looking at guidelines for curve sketching. You need to pay attention to what the domain is, x-intercepts and y-intercepts. An x-intercept is where the function is equal to 0. Y-intercept is where x equals 0 plugged into the function. Do you see if you've got any symmetry on this thing, whether it's odd, even, or some periodic? Isotopes. We'll get into isotopes later, but isotopes are places that you can't, don't exist. And basically, if you have a fraction, it's where you divide by 0 at. It's called a vertical isotope. You also have horizontal isotopes, and that deals with the degree of the numerator versus the degree of the denominator. Again, something we covered in high school algebra 2, but actually, when you see the next problem, I'll actually describe that one a little bit better. Okay, max min values, you know how to get max mins. This is your calculus. Take derivative, set equals 0, and solve, and where the derivative doesn't exist at. Intervals of increase and decrease, let's draw that number line stuff there and with that. Intervals of concavity, but before you find intervals of concavity, you've got to find inflection numbers. That's where the second derivative equals 0. Intervals of concavity is the number line for the second derivative. And then you put it all together, and from that, you should be able to analyze what the graph looks like. All right, so look at this problem right here. I got f of x equals x cubed plus 9x squared plus 15x plus 1. Okay? What is the domain? What kind of numbers can I plug into this thing? All real numbers. It's a polynomial. You can chuck in negative numbers, cubic, square, whatever, times 15. You can plug in positive numbers. You can plug in 0. The domain is all real numbers, negative infinity to infinity. Typically, we describe things through interval notation. X-intercepts and y-intercepts. Well, let's see here. X-intercepts are going to be kind of tough here on this one. But I can definitely give me my y-intercepts. I mean, go for the ones that you can find. What I mean by that is, how do I find a y-intercept? You set x equal to 0. And when I set x equal to 0, I'm going to get a point. X is 0. What's y going to be? You plug in 0 in this thing. What's your y-coordinate? 1. So at the point 0, 1, I go ahead and graph that guy because I know that's a point on the graph. How do I find x-intercepts? To find an x-intercept, you set y equal to 0. Now, this one is not a nice function in that sense, because if I put 0 equals x cubed minus 9x squared plus 15x plus 1, I don't think that's actually going to work out real well for me to find the x-intercepts. And let me explain why. Typically, we want to do something like factor by grouping or some kind of, if you can find them. And I can pull out in the first two terms, I can pull out an x squared, but I can't pull anything out of the second two terms. And I want to pull out something that they have in common, and what's in common, they don't have anything. So I can look at the calculator, but it's kind of the point is not to look at the calculator until we're done. So finding the y-intercepts is going to be incredibly difficult without doing the P over Q method and stuff like that. This stuff is supposed to be quick graphing. So if you can't find it, move on. Okay? So the y-intercepts is painful, so I'm going to move on for that one. I'm assuming the x-intercept. Y-intercepts are real easy. The x-intercepts are, quite in this problem, quite painful because there's no easy way of solving for x on this thing. And you're looking for the easy way. Odd, even, or symmetric, what do we got here is this. That's odd, because x cubed, minus an even, plus an odd, that thing's going to be all mixed up, so this thing is not symmetric at all. It's not even, nor is it odd. I'm looking at the powers. If you all had a bunch of even powers, then the thing would be symmetrical with respect to the y-axis. If it's odd, the first quadrant looks like the third quadrant, except upside down. And the second quadrant looks like the fourth quadrant, except upside down. That's when you have just odd powers. I don't have any of that. Isotopes. The real isotopes you want to focus on are vertical isotopes. That's where you set the denominator, deno, equal to 0. But do you even have a denominator in this problem? No, this is not a fraction, so you don't have to worry about isotopes. You only have isotopes when you're dealing with fractions. I'm trying to graph rational functions, the fancy name for fractional graphs. All right, max min values. That's something we can do. How do you find max min graphs? What are you going to do? Max min values, what are you going to do? Take derivative. Welcome to calculus. What is the derivative of x cubed minus 9x squared plus 15x plus 1? 3x squared minus 18x plus 15. Okay? This looks like a little better. I'm going to set it equal to 0 and solve. I believe I can factor out an x. Factor out a 3. That's going to leave me with x squared minus 6x plus 5 equals 0. Does that factor? 1 times what is 5? That adds up to be 6. 5 and 1. So this is x minus 5 times x minus 1 equals 0. That means when you set all factors that have x in it equal to 0, x is going to be equal to what? 1 and 5. But these are called, again, getting into the terminology of this stuff, because on my test and the final exam, I'm going to hit you on the terminology. When I take the derivative, set it equal to 0 and solve for x, I get what we call a critical number. If we're going to graph this stuff, I don't want just a critical number. I want the critical point. How do I get the point? I plug it back into the original equation to get the y-coordinate here. So x is 1 and x is 5. So I'm going to plug 1 into this thing. See, 1 cubed minus 9 times 1 squared plus 15 times 1 plus 1. When I plug in 1 in this thing, I kind of did it in my head. That's 1 and 1 make 2. Minus 9 and 15, that's 6. 6 and 2, I got 8. Did you guys get 8? But when I plug in 5, I got negative 24. You're right, I used my calculator to plug it in. Thank you. Negative 24. And of course, it's negative 24. And I put the standard grid on this thing, and where's negative 24 at? I don't know, somewhere in the next county. I don't know. So let's plot them. All right, 1, I'm going to go up to 8, which is right about there, 1, 8. But I'm going to guesstimate where 5, negative 24 is. I declare you to be the point 5, negative 24. I'm sorry. It's off my grid. There you go. There he is down there. Okay? Now, in terms of maximums and mins, before we figure it out, I want to figure out intervals of increase and decrease. Anytime you guys hear the word intervals, what are you going to do? Draw a number line. I'm going to put my critical numbers on there. What are they? In order, 1 and 5. And I tell you, I know it's pretty obvious for most folks, but some folks aren't listening to me. They're going to draw the number line because they've been programmed. Intervals, draw a number line. Good, that's great. But remember, it's a number line, so the numbers have to be in order. How many students have I seen? You get 3 numbers like negative 5, 2, and 7. They'll put 7 over here, 2 in the middle, and negative 5 over here. And then they can't figure out why their number line doesn't quite match up to anything in the world. Because the numbers have to be in order if you're going to actually do this stuff in order. So just keep that in mind when you're putting the numbers on the number line. So now we're going to do test values. This is a first derivative number line. So pick a number less than 1. I choose 2. Pick a number between, I choose 0 because I have a brain. Sorry about that. I should use it. A 0. Pick a number between 1 and 5. That's when I'm going to pick 2. And pick a number bigger than 5, I choose 6. And I'm going to plug it into my derivative here. But I'm going to show you a trick. If I'm not allowed to use a calculator on this stuff, and that should scare most of you people, but I do reserve the right to do this. If I plug in 0, I would use this break equation right there, and it's easy to plug it in. What do I get? 0 squared, 0, 3 times 0 squared minus 18 times 0 plus 15 is what? Try again. 0 squared times 3 minus 18 times 0 plus 15. Okay, plus 15. So that's positive. That's all you care about is what sign it is. Mm-hmm. Plug in 2. I'll use the factored form. Watch. What is 2 minus 5? Negative 3. What is 2 minus 1? 1. So I've got 3 times negative 3 times 1. 3 times negative 3 is negative 9 times 1 is negative 9. Decreasing in that interval. And then plug in 6, again, use the factored form of your derivative, which will be 6 minus 1, 6 minus 5, which is 1. 6 minus 1, which is 5. So that's 1 times 5 times 3. You're back to 15 again. And don't care what the number is. The big deal is, what sign is it? It's positive. Because they're asking you a question. They want the intervals of increase and decrease. So please tell me where it's increasing at and where it's decreasing at. It's increasing at negative infinity to? No. Positive 1. Union 5 to infinity. Where's it decreasing at? Between 1 and 5. But that'll be a question I'm definitely going to ask you guys on the test. And that's a negative infinity in case you guys can't read my handwriting there. Does that make sense? Okay? Which tells me something about my points. This is called the first derivative test. Between negative infinity to 1, I am increasing. That means I'm going up. I hit 1, then I am decreasing. I'm going down. What kind of point does that make 1? Maximum. Relative maximum. Okay, or local maximum. If I go down until I hit 5 and then go back up again, what kind of point does that make 5? That's at a minimum. Relative or local minimum. Okay? Now let's talk about intervals of concavity. Before I talk about intervals of concavity, I got to talk about IPs. What's an IP stand for? Inflection point. How do you find an inflection point? You take the second derivative, set it equals 0 and solve. So what's my second derivative on this thing? Well, there's my first derivative, 3x squared minus 18x plus 15. The second derivative would be 6x minus 18. Set it equal to 0 and solve. That's going to give me 6x, add 18 to both sides, equals 18 divided by 6. That implies x equals what? 3. But I want a point. So x is 3. What's the y coordinate? I want to plug it back in where? To the original equation. So I'm putting on my calculator. 3 cubed minus 9 times 3 squared plus 15 times 3 plus 1. And when I did that, I got negative 8. You see how I got my y coordinate? I did it off screen on the calculator. I did plug it in, but I plugged in 3 cubed minus 9 times 3 squared plus 15 times 3 plus 1, and negative 8 popped out. So 3 negative 8 would be right about there. That's my IP. This is my CP here, and there's another CP. Okay? But they want intervals of concavity. Anytime you hear the word intervals, what are you going to do? Draw a number line. But this is a second derivative concavity number line. I'm going to put my inflection number on there, 3, and I'm going to pick test values. Pick a number less than 3. I have a brain, I choose 0. Pick a number bigger than 3, I choose 4. And I'm going to plug it into my second derivative, 6x minus 18. Plugging in 0, I get negative 18. Don't care what the number is, it's negative. That tells me I am concave down in that interval. Concave down between negative infinity to 3. Always open parentheses on intervals of increase and decrease and intervals of concavity. Right at the point, you always use open parentheses. Pick 4. Let's see, 6 times 4 is 24. And 24 minus 18 is 6. Don't care what the number is. I just care about the sign of it. It's positive, which tells me it's concave up there. So it is concave up, answering my questions here, between 3 and infinity. Which definitely changing concavity really does tell me that this is an inflection point. Now, I'm going to put all this stuff together, especially my two number lines, with my special dots here to get this guy. Starting at negative infinity, I am concave down, and I am increasing. If I am increasing and concave down, that means I've got to start at the bottom. Remember, I've got to hit this point right here. Go up. And be increasing. I made that point bigger because it's turned a little too far away. There you go. Concave down. This is concave down. See that bowness of it right there. I gotta hit that point. Then I hit this point, and then I come down. Once I hit 1, now I'm gonna be decreasing, but I'm gonna continue to be concave down until I hit this point. So this is decreasing, concave down, because you can see the newness of this thing here. Once I hit this point, which is the point 3, I'm now gonna be concave up, but I'll continue to decrease. This is concave up and decreasing. And then once I hit 5, I'm gonna be increasing and concave up, which looks like this. So that big old S looking thing there is my graph. And now I'm gonna type it in on my calculator. There it is. And I'm gonna graph it. And that's what it's supposed to look like. And notice it's off the screen down here at negative 24, so I'm feeling really good about my graph. Does that make sense? And of course, you will have a calculator on this next test, so use it. I mean, double check your answers on this stuff. If you screw up something or other, it actually show up on your picture going, wait a minute, it's supposed to be decreasing here, and it looks like I'm increasing. I must have made a mistake somewhere. Go back and figure it out where it was at. Does that make sense? Well, if you look at section 6.6, all I did was put one problem on there, because the interesting thing that they're doing on this one is we're going to be graphing rational functions. This is a rational function. So you notice that last problem I did, it's the same direction. So basically the last problem was in section 4.6, except it wasn't any isotopes on it. All right, so the two things that are different about graphing rational functions, and this is important, so watch this one, is this. The vertical isotope and the horizontal isotope and how these guys affect your intervals of concavity, intervals of increase and decrease. All right, first off, let's talk about how do you calculate a vertical isotope. To calculate a vertical isotope, what do? This is old college algebra stuff here. I have a fraction that I'm graphing. To find the vertical isotope, I'm going to set the denominator, I'm abbreviating this, deno, the denominator equal to 0. Does that make sense? Okay? And then you solve for x. There's also something called the horizontal isotope. How do you find a horizontal isotope? Not quite. That's actually the x-intercepts, but I'm going to talk about that in a second. The horizontal isotopes is three cases. This is called the horizontal isotope theorem. The horizontal isotope theorem. Again, it is something that we discussed light years ago in high school algebra 1, algebra 2, and college algebra and pre-calculus if you went that route. Here's the deal. Three cases. Case number one, if the degree of the top, the numerator, is less than the degree of the bottom, denominator, you're going to get y equals 0 is the horizontal isotope, which is the y equals 0 is the x-axis. Your x-axis becomes the horizontal isotope. Case number two, when the degree of the top is equal to the degree of the bottom, you're going to get y equals the ratio of leading coefficients. The ratio of the leading coefficients. The leading coefficients are the numbers attached to the degree term in the numerator and in the denominator. Since they're the same degree, you're going to do the ratio of the leading coefficients. And that's, and I'll blow this up for you guys sitting in the back. You guys can see this a little better. Ratio of leading COEF, coefficients. Okay? So, in case I had something like this, y equals 3x squared divided by y equals 5x squared. You got some other terms, don't care. But the degree of the top is 2, the degree of the bottom is 2. 3x squared over 5x squared, what would my horizontal isotope be? 3/5. You did the ratio of the leading coefficients. And then you got case number three. Case number three is the third case. The degree of the top is actually bigger than the degree of the bottom. That's the easiest case. There is no horizontal isotope. You get something called a slant isotope, and we're not going to worry about that in this class. So it's no horizontal isotope. So there's three cases for horizontal isotope. There's one thing you do for the vertical isotope, and that's set the denominator equals zero and solve for it. All right, so let's take a look at this thing here. Same directions as we had last time, except for this one, because it is a rational function, has this numerator-denominator factor to it, which means that I'm going to get some vertical isotope and horizontal isotope stuff out of it, possibly. So we're going to sketch this thing through our guidelines. Number one, what is the domain of this thing? Well, it's not all real numbers, because guess what? We're dividing by something or other. And what are you not allowed to divide by in mathematics? Zero. So the denominator, x squared minus 4, we're going to set that equal to 0. This thing's going to factor because it's a difference of squares. X plus 2 times x minus 2 equal to 0. Set each factor equal to 0. And that gives me x equals negative 2 and x equals positive 2. Does that make sense? And these are the points that I'm not allowed to have. Can have. You cannot have these points in this particular problem, because that would make you what? Divide by zero. So, what is my domain? Well, in English, it would be all real numbers except plus and minus 2. 2 and negative 2, right? But this is mathematics. We have to give our answers in mathematical interval notation form. So I have to skip over 2 and negative 2. So on number lines, this would be negative infinity, negative 2, union, negative 2 to 2, union, 2 to infinity. All real numbers except negative 2 and 2. And that's how you should write your answer. I'm skipping over negative 2, I'm skipping over positive 2, and I'm writing everybody else. All right? When you have, listen up, when you have a fraction, okay, and you're talking about vertical isotopes, you set the denominator equal to 0. So you actually figured out the vertical isotopes when you did this problem. But I'm interested in x-intercepts and y-intercepts. When you're dealing with fractions, to find the x-intercept, you set the numerator equal to 0. And for the y-intercept, you set x equal to 0. So look at my function. F of x equals x squared divided by x squared minus 4. What are my x-intercepts? Well, set the numerator equal to 0. What's my numerator? X squared equal to 0. And how would you solve for x if you had x squared equal 0? I would do what mathematically? Take square both sides and officially plus or minus. So if it was a number, it would be like plus or minus a number. But what's plus or minus? Zero. Zero. So you actually get the point 0, 0. And for the y-intercept, you're going to set x equals 0. So y would be equal to 0 squared over 0 squared minus 4, which is 0 divided by negative 4, which is 0. And it gives you the same point, 0, 0. So guess what? You're going through the origin on this graph. You're going through the point 0, 0, because the x-intercept is the y-intercept. Does that make sense? Now, let's look at symmetry on this thing. Look at your function here. This is x squared, that's even. This is x squared, that's even. And what is 4? Is considered constant. This is a degree 0. And what kind of number is 0? Is it even or odd? 0 is what? Check a pattern. What are the even numbers? 2, 4, 6, 8. Also, negative 2, negative 4, negative 6, negative 8. They're all even. What's in the middle? Catch a pattern. You differ by 2. 2, 4, 6, 8. If you go the other direction, you get 0, negative 2, negative 4, negative 6, negative 8. 0 is considered even. So this thing is even, even, and even on top. Well, when you have even pretty much times even, you get even. Even divided by even is going to be even. Difference of evens is even. This thing is actually even. And what does it mean to be even? Symmetry? It is symmetric with respect to the y-axis. Keep that in mind. When I'm graphing this thing, I'm going to have symmetry with respect to the y-axis, which means my y-axis is going to split this graph right down the middle, and the left half looks like the right half. It's called symmetry. If it was odd, it would be symmetric to their origin. The first quadrant looks like the third quadrant, except upside down. Second quadrant looks like fourth quadrant, except upside down. This one's even. What about isotopes? Well, we just figured out our vertical isotopes a few seconds ago. What are my vertical isotopes? But, listen up. Now we're starting to be technical about this stuff. What I mean by technical is the way you're going to write your answer. A vertical isotope is x equals, a horizontal isotope is described as y equals. So, you nailed it, but what is it? X equals 2 and x equals negative 2. And what does x equal 2 look like? That is a vertical line at negative 2. So put yourself a nice little dotted line right here, right at negative 2, all the way down. This is x equals negative 2 vertical isotope. The other one is x equals positive 2. So put a dotted line right at x equals positive 2 and label him as x equals 2 vertical isotope. But there's another type of isotope too. It's the horizontal isotope. What is the horizontal isotope in this problem? Well, horizontal isotope deals with the degree of the top versus the degree of the bottom. What is the degree of the top? Now, look at it again. What is the degree of the top?
Two.
What is the degree of the bottom? Two. The degree of the top is equal to the degree of the bottom. So what is my horizontal isotope? It's y equals the ratio of leading coefficients. What is the leading coefficient numerator? Leading coefficient in the denominator, understood to be 1. So what is it? Y equals officially 1 over 1, which is 1. The ratio of the leading coefficient. Y equals 1 is a horizontal line. So make a little dot at y equals 1, horizontal line, and label them y equals 1, horizontal isotope. Horizontal isotope tells you what's happening at the ends, your negative infinity and positive infinity, as x gets really big negatively and really big positively, if you think about it. All right, here it comes. Find max min values and intervals of increase and decrease. How am I going to find my max min values? What am I going to do? Find them. Calculus. Before I even do any kind of number line, what do I got to do when I hear the word max min? Critical numbers. What do I do? Take the derivative. Look at this problem. It is x squared divided by x squared minus 4. What rule do I have to use to take the derivative of this guy? Quotient rule. What is the quotient rule? Great time to review for this thing. In a month, we got a final exam. Let's draw the top times the bottom minus the top. Try to draw the bottom all to the bottom squared. So it's draw the top. What's draw the top? 2x times the bottom, x squared minus 4, minus the top, x squared times draw the bottom, 2x all over the bottom, x squared minus 4 squared. Clean him up. This is going to be equal to, when I distribute here, this is going to give me 2x cubed minus 8x minus 2x cubed all over x squared minus 4 squared. These guys cancel. You are left with negative 8x over x squared minus 4 squared. There's my derivative. How do I find max mins again? I'm going to take this derivative and do what with it? Set him equal to 0. When you set him equal to 0, solve for x. Anytime I have a fraction equals 0, I'm always going to get rid of my fraction by multiplying both sides by the common only denominator here. So I'm going to multiply both sides by x squared minus 4 squared. But here's the pattern. When you multiply x squared minus 4, it cancels the denominator on the left. That just gives me negative 8x. Equals what? 0 times anybody?
0.
And so it's just like setting the numerator equal to 0. Does that make sense? Now solve for x here. Divide by negative 8. That gives me x equals 0, but I want a point. This will be my critical point. X is 0. But what's y going to be equal to if x is equal to 0? You go back to the original equation and plug it in, and we've already found that point. 0, 0. Yes, sir. Question. All right. So if I'm trying to solve, for x. I've got my derivative, negative 8x divided by x squared minus 4 quantity squared. I'm going to set equal to 0. Anytime you're trying to solve a fraction, any fraction, equal to 0, you get rid of your denominator by multiplying both sides by your denominator. Always your first move. So I'm going to multiply both sides by x squared minus 4 squared. On the left, they'll end up canceling. But on the right, it's 0. You set it equal to 0. What's 0 times anybody? 0. So this cancels, and 0 times anybody equals 0. So it's just like setting the numerator equal to 0. And then solving for x divided by negative 8. And so I got x equals 0. When you go back and plug it back into the original equation, 0 squared is 0 divided by 0 squared minus 4. That's 0 divided by negative 4, which is 0. That point right there, the only point that we actually plotted, actually is a max min point. It's a critical point. What kind of point is it? I don't know yet. We're about to find out by doing the intervals of concavity. I'm sorry, intervals of increase and decrease first. Intervals of increase and decrease. So anytime they ask for the intervals, what are you going to do? But here's the deal. Get this in your notes, because here's where most people are going to screw this up. What number am I going to put on my number line? 0, my critical number. But that's not the only point I'm going to put. There are two points that do not exist in this function. I've got to continue to make sure they don't exist, so I have to omit them from all number lines. What are the two points that do not exist in this function? Your vertical isomtotes, negative 2 and positive 2. And I'm putting little open circles around there because these are the VAs. Always put your vertical isomtotes in your number line because they don't exist, so it's really dividing your graph into three different parts. Does that make sense? Don't forget to put the vertical isomtope on your number line on when you have a fraction. So now I'm going to do some test values. Pick a number, and this is a first derivative graph here. Pick a number less than negative 2. I choose negative 3. Pick a number between negative 2 and 0. Negative 1. Pick a number between 0 and 2. Positive 1. And pick a number bigger than 2. I choose 3. And these are the numbers I'm going to plug into my derivative. Remember, my derivative, I'll recopy them for you, was negative 8x divided by x squared minus 4 squared. You are going to get some fractions. Why? Because your functions are fractions. All right, you don't care about the numbers. Care about the signs. So I'm going to do this on my old calculator here. So clear them off the nice little screen here to show you. I'm actually using my calculator here. This will be negative 8 times plugging in negative 3 in for x divided by parentheses, another parentheses, negative 3 squared minus 4, close parentheses squared. I'm showing you how I'm typing on the calculator because watch these parentheses. You're plugging in negative inside of a square. You got to put parentheses around it. Otherwise, the calculator will give you the wrong answer. Because it'll do order of operations and square it before taking a negative. So you got to put in parentheses around it. What do I get? I don't care. A number. I got number 0.96. That's awesome. Who cares? What sign is 0.96?
Positive.
Because there's some symmetry going on, I expect to see some of the same numbers again. Now plug in negative 1 into this thing. So call it back down. Replace all your negative 3s with negative 1s. What do I get? I get 0.8889, whatever. 0.89. Don't care what the number is, what sign of it? And you notice it didn't change signs. That's why you have to do these test values. Plug in positive 1. Call it back down again. And I'm going to delete all the little negatives out of it. So I'm using my recall button on this thing just to make it a little nicer. So now I'm plugging in a 1 into all my into my derivatives for all the x's. And what do I get? Now there's that symmetry. I get the same number, but this time it's negative. Negative 0.89. Which means it's negative. And now I'm going to plug in 3 into this thing. So call it back down again. For all the 1's, plug in a 3. And what a surprise, I'm going to get a negative 0.96, which is back to negative. But listen to my words, because this is how I'm going to put it on the test. I'm going to write down here, increase. I'm going to leave a little space right beside it. I'm going to put decrease and put a little space right beside it, because you've got to fill in the spaces for me. What is the intervals of increase? What's the intervals of decrease? What's the intervals of increase? Negative infinity up to what? You've got to skip over negative 2 because it's a vertical isotope. You've got to skip over that point. Union, negative 2, all the way up to 0. What's my intervals of decrease? 0 to 2. Union, pick it up again, 2 to infinity. Well, yes, sir. Question. Yes. Yeah, gotta have parentheses. Bracket means it includes. You can't include 2 because it doesn't exist on the graph, and it can't include 0 because right at 0, it's neither increasing nor decreasing. So with this intervals of concavity stuff and intervals of increase and decrease, you always use open parentheses, always, including web work. You put a bracket, web work count it wrong. Okay? What about intervals of concavity? Well, that'll be more interesting. Now I got to take the second derivative. Let's sit back and enjoy this one. All right, what is the second derivative? I got negative 8x divided by x squared minus 4 squared. Great practice. To do the derivative of negative 8x divided by x squared minus 4 quantity squared, I've got to use the quotient rule. Drill the top times the bottom minus the top, trying to drill the bottom all over the bottom squared. Drum it in your head. When you're 90 years old, you're going to have nightmares with me and your brain. That's my job. And look at that denominator. What kind of rule I got to use that denominator? Chain rule. Drill the outside, inside, stay the same time, drill the inside. This thing's going to be nasty. Enjoy. All right. Drill the top. What's the derivative of negative 8x? Drill the top times the bottom. X squared minus 4 squared. Minus the top, negative 8x. Time to drill the bottom. Chain rule. Drill the outside. 2 pops out front. The inside, x squared minus 4 stays the same. Raised to the first power. Time to drill the inside, which is 2x. All over the bottom, x squared minus 4 squared. All over the bottom, squared. So I got a squared going on here. Does that make sense? Now, clean it up. This is equal to negative 8 times x squared minus 4 squared. Minus a minus is going to make it a positive. I got 8x times 2 times a 2x. Well, 8x, let's see, 2 times 2x is 4x. 4x times 8x is what? 32x squared times x squared minus 4, the first power, all over x squared minus 4. Power to a power, what do I do with the power? Now, try again. Power raised to a power. Power raised to a power, exponential properties, you multiply them. 2 times 2 is 4. Now, clean it up some more. You want to factor that numerator out. What do you have in common? What can you factor out of this thing? I can factor out an 8. I can pull out an x squared minus 4. I'm going to factor out an 8 times an x squared minus 4. So here's my second derivative. Okay. What am I left with? Here's a big old bracket when I'm factoring it out. I'm left with a negative x squared minus 4 plus, let's see here, 32. I factored out an 8 out of 32. What am I left with? 4. X squared. But notice, I factor out the x squared minus 4, so that term is completely gone. All over x squared minus 4. Beautiful algebra, but you've got to clean it up. Now, what is this negative going to do to the stuff inside the parentheses, this x squared minus 4? That's going to switch it up. It'll be negative x squared plus 4. And I just wrote it above it because I'm going to combine like terms. So my derivative is going to be, oh, also, one other thing. What is x squared minus 4 divided by x squared minus 4 to the 4th power? Yes. Cancel, and what are you left with? 3 of them down there. One of those guys will cancel. So you're left with 8 times, you got negative x squared plus 4x squared is actually 3x squared. And you've got plus 4 all over x squared minus 4 cubed. Congratulations. As nasty as it is, you've got the derivative. Second derivative, that is. Does that make sense? All right. How do you find inflection points? Oh, question. Yes, sir. Negative x squared, I would say it equals x squared minus 4, but that negative distributed because it was inside parentheses, right?
I was just wondering if you could have left that there and canceled toward the bottom and changed the four x squared to the bottom.
No. No, because, well, if you multiply the top and bottom by negative 1, yeah, but that's not going to make it any better. You got negative and denominator, it's not going to change anything. But all I did was just distribute the negative so I can combine like terms. Negative x squared plus 4x squared. Actually, the negatives go away. This is where your 3x squared comes from. But that negative did hit that negative 4, making it a positive 4. And that's going to make a difference because now, how do I find inflection points? I'm going to take my second derivative, which is 8 times 3x squared plus 4 over x squared minus 4 cubed. Set equals 0. All right, so let's go through this. I've got a nasty looking fraction equal to 0, and I need to solve for x. What's my next move? Multiply by your denominator. Both sides are going to get hit by x squared minus 4 cubed. X squared minus 4 cubed. This cancels, leaving me, and this time 0 is 0, leaves me with 8 times 3x squared plus 4 equals 0. It's just like setting the numerator equal to 0. Just to save myself some time, I'm going to divide by 8. When I divide both sides by 8 to get rid of that part, I'm left with 3x squared plus 4 equals 0. Because 0 divided by 8 is 0. 0 on top is 0. 0 on bottom doesn't exist. Does that make sense? Now, how would you solve for x? What would you do next? I would subtract 4. So that leaves me with 3x squared equals negative 4. Then I'm going to divide by 3. That leaves me with x squared equals negative 4 over 3. And all this work, what do I got to do to get rid of a square? Square root of both sides. Officially plus or minus, but who cares? What is the square root of negative 4 thirds? What are you not allowed to take the square root or any even root off? Negative number. You got a negative number underneath the radical. What does that tell me? D-N-E. No solution. No inflection numbers. No IPs, no inflection points. Does that make sense? But I'm not done yet because I still got to find intervals of concavity. Even though I don't have any inflection numbers, that's okay. I have to have intervals of concavity, so what am I going to have to do? Draw a number line. I work real hard to leave this little spot right here. Here it is. Here comes my number line. But what numbers do I have to put on my number lines? Whether it's increase or decrease or concavity, don't forget to put these numbers on your number line when you've got rational functions. What are those numbers? The vertical isotopes. Because they didn't exist with the function, they don't exist with the first derivative, they don't exist with the second derivative. Here's my second derivative right here. And notice I still got x squared minus 4 in the denominator, which means x can't be 2 or negative 2. So I've got to omit those guys. Negative 2 and 2. But there are no inflection numbers. So now I'm going to sit there and use my calculator to figure this thing out. But I'm going to plug a number less than negative 2 into my second derivative. This is my second derivative graph. I'm going to plug in negative 3. I'm going to plug in 0. And I'm going to plug in positive 3 into my second derivative. Okay? So here we go. There's my second derivative right there, plugging in negative 3. That'll be 8 parentheses, 3 times another parentheses, negative 3, close parentheses, squared, plus 4, close parentheses for the numerator, divided by parentheses, another parentheses, negative 3 squared, minus 4, close parentheses, cubed. Notice how I typed it in. Exactly the way it looks. Hit enter. Don't care what the number is, I got 1.984. So 1.984. What sign is 1.984?
Positive.
That means I am concave up. Does that make sense? Plug in zeros. Second entry, change all those negative threes to zeros. Now, negative zero is the same thing as zero, but will matter when I recall it again for the next number. So I'm going ahead and clean it up right now. What do I get? Negative 0.5. Don't care what the number is. What sign is it?
Negative.
That tells me it's concave down in that interval. And now I want to type in a 3, and because of symmetry, I should be getting very similar numbers here, but let's take a look. Yep, what a surprise. I get 1.984, which is back to being positive. So I have to give my concavity, where is it concave up at? And it's negative infinity to negative 2, union 2 to infinity. Where is it concave down at? Negative 2 to 2. So there is my intervals of concavity and written in the form that I'd like to see on the test. Okay. Now, last thing. Let's put it all on the graph and then check the calculator to make sure we got it right. So here we go. Look at these two number lines and remember, here's the deal. Listen up and listen good. What do vertical and horizontal isotopes do? Horizontal isotopes tell you what's going on as x approaches negative infinity and x approaches positive infinity. I'm going to be going along this line here. Vertical isotopes are lines I can't cross. If I can't cross them, I got only two options. I'm either going to blow up or blow down. So because I can't cross these lines. So here we go. Start with negative infinity. Negative infinity right here, I am going to be increasing, but my concavity is going to be up. Increasing up. And I'm starting at this point because I started the horizontal isotope on the left. I've got to increase, and I got to go up. Increasing and concave up looks like this, and I can't cross a vertical isotope, which means I have to blow up. I'm not going to cross a vertical isotope as I approach it. I either got to blow up or blow down. To increase and be concave up, I've got to do this. Now, skip over negative 2. Skipping over negative 2 on both number lines here, I'm now going to be increasing again, but between negative 2 and 0, let me get my number line here. Between negative 2 and positive 2, I've got to be concave down. All right, so listen, and I'm asking a question. It's a theory question. How do I increase and be concave down? Do I start at the top or the bottom? See, I can't cross a vertical isotope, so I either end at the top or bottom, and I start at the top or bottom. Since I have to increase, I can't increase at the top and keep on going. I got to increase and start at the bottom and increase. Does that make sense? So it's going to be like this. I got to increase and be concave down. So it looks like this. But once I pass zero, I stop increasing and I start to decrease. But I am still concave down. Now I'm decreasing and concave down, so I have this particular look to it, which makes 2 an actual maximum point. The 0.00. 0.00 is actually a maximum point. It's a local maximum. And then once I pass 2, now look what I got. I'm passing 2 on my number lines. I've got to decrease, but I got to be concave up. If I'm decreasing, do I start at the top or bottom to show decreasing? I start at the top, and then I have to decrease, and I got to hit that line there. Because I remember, I got to end at this point right over here on the horizontal isotope. So this is according to the graph. Now, let's go in here to the calculator and just double check everything. X squared divided by parentheses x squared minus 4, close parentheses. And I'm going to hit the old zoom 6 on it, and let's see if I don't get the exact same picture that I got that I just graphed through the groups. You're right. These horizontal and vertical isotopes put a new component to this stuff and makes it a little tougher, but the key to it is catch the pattern on it. Does that make sense? And you'll notice that it's even symmetry because the left half does look exactly like the right half. So I got that nice mirror image stuff going on. But the only way you're going to really learn this stuff is practice. Speaking of practicing, before I move on to the next section, have you been paying attention to your Moodle site? Good. So I've got your web page up here, and I went ahead and clicked on web work, and here's my web work. So what's going on here? You've got a few web works coming due here, but I've gave you some time here. So you got this curve sketching, and then after that we got the applied max min problems. Max min problems called optimization, and then after that differential. So all this is what's going to be on your next test. Okay, and I've already got your due dates. I already got it open for you, so get started on it. Well, we're going to move on to next, max min problems. So let's take a look at our next section. Next section after 4.6 is, for math people, don't think too deep, 4.7. All right. Take a look at this particular problem for a second. Yep, and it's word problems. Max min word problems. But think about this for a second. You have already been programmed personally by me. Anytime you want to maximize or minimize something, brother, what are you going to do? Take derivative, set it equal to your favorite number, zero, and solve. And also check where the derivative doesn't exist at in case you have a strange function that has some points that don't exist. But maximums and minimums, as a catchphrase, is where the derivative is equal to zero and you solve. It's your critical numbers. Does that make sense? All right. Here's a particular problem. We'll read it first and then we'll talk about it. Farmer Brown has 1,200 feet of fencing to create a rectangular pen that will be adjacent to a river. If he does not need to put any fence along the side that borders the river, what dimensions will maximize the area of the pen, and what is the maximum area of the pen? And don't forget your units on this thing. This is a real world problem here. We got a farmer who's got a river going through his property, and he wants to pen in a bunch of cows. But you want to have the ability for the cows to get down to the river to get a drink of water, probably a creek or something like that. Hopefully not a river. But, you know, the idea is that you got a situation here. And he wants to figure out, he's got lots of land, but he's only got 1,200 feet of fencing. He wants to figure out what's the maximum area he can produce so his cows can roam around, free-range cows, you know, next to be higher or something. But whatever. The fact is, what's the biggest pen we can make? All right, I'm going to give you steps for this. This is called optimization problems. I do the same steps every time. And this one I'm going to write up for you. So here we go. Steps for optimization, max min problems. Steps for max min problems. All right. Step number one, read problem. Draw a picture and label. And just like when you guys did the related rate kind of problems, you had to do kind of the same thing. You come up with your own letters. You've got to come up with a scenario that's going on here. All right, but here's the other thing you've got to do. Step two, you are going to come up with the objective equation. Now, I'm using fancy terms here, but my fancy terms are terms I came up with, so they're not that fancy. It just sounds fancy. Objective equation. What is your objective in life? You were in a calculus class. Your objective in life is to take a derivative of somebody, set it equal to zero, and solve, because this is how you maximize or minimize. It's the equation you want to take derivative of. That's the objective in life, is to take derivative, set it equal to zero, and solve, to maximize and or minimize, depending on the circumstance. So this will be the equation you want to take derivative of. That's your objective. Does that make sense? Then, step number three, you're going to come up with the what we call the constraint equation. Usually, you are under some kind of constraint. There's some kind of mathematical numbering here that we have to adhere to. If that wasn't the case, let me tell you, Farmer Brown should make his pen negative infinity by, oh, excuse me, infinity by infinity. That's how big we should make the pen, and the cows can roam all over the earth. Okay? But we can't do that. He's limited the land he's got. He's limited the amount of fencing he's got. So there's some kind of limiting aspect. The equation for that limiting aspect that's in the problem, the equation for the numbers in the problem, if you want it easier than that, it's called the constraint equation. Because here's what you do. Step number four. Solve the constraint equation for one variable and substitute into the objective equation and clean up. Because here's your problem with your objective equation. It's going to have too many variables in it. You got variables all over the place with this stuff. But by taking the constraint equation and solving for one of the variables and plugging it into the objective equation, that will make your objective equation have only one variable in it. Because here comes step number five. Step number five is the moneymaker. Here it is. Welcome to calculus. How do I maximize or minimize? Take the what? Derivative equal to zero and solve for x, or whatever variable you have. Traditional, my x guy here. But wait a minute, that step number five is going to get you to the goal line, but you got to score. Step number six is how you score the big points on the problem. Step number six, go back and answer the question. That's amazing to me, but I had so many students sit there and get the answer, x equals 5, which is absolutely correct. But the question is, what is the dimensions of the rectangle? Well, the dimension of a rectangle is 2 dimensions. It has a length and a width. You got to take that x equals 5 and go back and answer whatever question they have for you so you can get full point total. Does that make sense? 6 steps to glory. Every time. Sometimes I don't use all these 6 steps, but usually I'll use even a combination of these 6 steps, but these 6 steps will win you every max min problem there is. Sometimes they're even so much easier that I don't even need all 6 steps, but if the worst case problems, I'll use all 6 steps. Let's take a look at this problem again. Farmer Brown has 1,200 feet of fencing to create a rectangular pen that will be adjacent to a river. I drew you a picture on this thing. If he does not need to put any fencing along the side of the borders of the river, what dimensions will maximize the area? And what is the maximum area? I got 2 questions on this one. All right, so step one, I have read the problem. Step two, I'm going to come up with the objective equation. What is my objective here? To maximize what? Area. So area is equal to, this one I went ahead and drew for you, so I gave you your letters. So I'm using L's and W's. What is the area of a rectangle? No, that's the perimeter. What's the area of a rectangle? No, not 1/2 anything. What's the area of a rectangle? You guys are worrying me. Length times width. This is not major math here. This is something we did in kindergarten. Area is equal to length times width. You with me? It's not a triangle. It's not an elliptical octagon prism thing here. No, it's a rectangle. Length times width. Don't think too deep on this stuff, guys. All right, so this right here, you see him? We want to maximize. You know what I want to do? I want to take rid of this guy, set him equal to 0, and solve. I got a problem. What's my problem? No, too many variables. I got 2 variables. So there's the objective equation, objective EQ. Now I'm going to come over here, and this third step is come up with the constraint equation. What constraint did they give me? They gave me some numbers on this problem. What was it? I got fencing. It's supposed to be 1,200 feet. I got 1,200 feet of fencing. There's my constraint. There's my number. Write an equation for this. Where are we actually putting fencing at? I'm going to put fencing here. I'm going to put fence here. I'm going to put fence here. I'm not going to put a fence down by the river, right? So what is an equation of that? How many W's I got? I got 2 W's and I got 1 L. So 2 W's. Plus 1L has got to be equal to the amount of fencing I'm going to use, which is 1,200. Because I'm going to use all my fence. That'll give me my biggest area. Does that make sense? That's the constraint equation. The equation that uses the given information. Step number three. Solve the constraint equation for one of the variables. Which variable is easy to solve for? I believe L. How would you solve for L? L equals, no, that's a plus there, so I'm going to move this other side. I'm going to subtract 2W from both sides. So L equals 1,200 minus 2W. And what am I going to do with this L equals 1,200 minus 2W? I'm going to plug it in into my objective equation, because this is my number one equation right here, because this is the guy I want to take rid of all. This is going to give me the equation L is equal to 1,200 minus 2W times W. But I also said this in my third step, actually my fourth step. Solve the constraint equation for one of the variables, plug it into the objective equation, and clean him up. How would you clean him up? I would distribute. So area is equal to 1,200W minus 2W squared. There it is. Now, step number five. This is what we're looking for in terms of grading your responses and stuff. How does calculus play a part? I want to maximize this dude. I'm going to take my derivative. It's one variable, so we'll just call it a prime here. Which is what? What's the derivative of 1,200W? 1,200 minus what's the derivative of 2W squared? 4W. Then we're going to set that equal to 0. You take derivative to maximize or minimize. You take derivative, set it equal to 0, and you're going to solve. I'm going to add 4W to both sides. That's going to give me 1,200 equals 4W. And to solve for W, I'm going to divide by 4. So instead of X, I'm solving for W. What is 1,200 divided by 4? 300. Wait, back comes step number 6. Okay, this is why I put step number 6 on there. We got the answer. We are at the goal line. Break the plane and get the points. Here we go. Answer the questions. What were the questions? There were two questions. What are the dimensions? What's the dimensions of my rectangle here? Length by what? Width. We got width and we need length. What is the width? 300 what? What would width be measured in? What are my units here? Feet. What about the length? Go back to the constraint equation. The constraint equation is your linking variable equation. Once you get one variable, use the constraint equation and link to the other variable. L would be equal to 1,200 minus 2 times W, but we know W is equal to 300. So 2 times 300 is 600. 1,200 minus 600 is 600. So the length has to be 600 feet. There is part A to my ultimate victory. I'm just collecting a bunch of points here. And then what was part B question they wanted on this thing? What was the maximum area? Well, area is equal to the length times the width. So area would be equal to 300 times 600, which is equal to what? What is 300 times 600? 180,000, but don't forget your units. This is a math class that has some physics components to it. We won't fit. Very good. It's area, so it's square feet square. Does that make sense? Did I lose you guys anywhere? Questions? Remember, this is a great problem to get started on this thing, but I want you guys to start practicing on this, because this is a very large section. Study it, and I'll see you guys. No class on Friday, remember? All right, because it is Easter, Good Friday. So you're off the hook, Zach. And then class on Monday, we'll pick this up. See you guys then.